With the surprise landing of the Chinese rover Yutu-2, or the Jade Rabbit 2, and the Chang'e lander 4 on the far side of the moon on the 3rd of January 2019, I thought it'd be interesting to see what sort of things we've actually put up on the moon and to speculate on what might happen to them in the future. Now, it will come as no surprise that the Apollo missions have left behind the most amount of items, but long before they were even thought of, the Soviets pulled off something that, not for the first time, the US thought they couldn't actually do. In 1959, the Soviet Lunar 2 probe was the first man-made object to intentionally impact onto the lunar surface. The closest the US had got to the moon by then was with the Pioneer 4, but that was 60,000 kilometers away, which was a bit of a shock because the US believed that while the Soviets had bigger rockets, they were lacking the precision in their navigation and guidance systems. Although these early probes were designed to crash into the moon, in a piece of pure propaganda, Lunar 2 left behind a calling card to remind everyone else that they were here first. Lunar 2 was loaded not only with experiments, but two small spheres, one 7.5 centimeters and the other 12 centimeters across, and made from pentagonal pennants, each stamped with the insignia of the Soviet Union and the date 1959 on the larger of the two. These spheres had an explosive core and were designed to explode and scatter the pennants on impact. Although these were the very first man-made items to make it to the moon, their fate is unknown as Lunar 2 impacted at a speed of around 3.3 kilometers per second, about 12,000 kilometers an hour, and were probably vaporized on impact. A third sphere was in the Lunar 2's rocket body, which crashed about 30 minutes later. That was filled with liquid and aluminium strips with the year 1959 and Union of Soviet Socialist Republics engraved upon them. As the space race intensified, the lunar research also increased. The US sent the Ranger probes to take close-up images of the moon. They did this like the Soviet lunar probes by crashing into the moon whilst transmitting live TV signals back to Earth. At one point, it was called the Shoot and Hope program because the first 6 out of 9 Ranger probes either failed on the launch pad, missed the moon completely, or failed before reaching the moon's surface. This was followed up by the Surveyor program to find out more about the actual surface at potential landing sites for Apollo, as it was feared by some that any lander would just sink and disappear into the lunar dust. 5 out of the 7 surveyors successfully landed and proved that theory was groundless. Also around this time, the Lunar Orbiter program was the first NASA craft to orbit and survey the moon, including mapping its gravitational field, again for the Apollo missions. After their missions were complete, the orbiters were deorbited and crashed into the moon so they wouldn't pose any threat to the Apollo missions, with lunar orbiters 1, 2 and 3 ending up on the far side of the moon. The Soviets had a similarly hit-and-miss success rate, with the first 4 attempts at a soft landing failed. Finally, on the 3rd of Feb 1966, Lunar 9 became the first lunar lander to achieve and survive a soft landing. Something which is often overlooked is that the rockets that carried the spacecraft also ended up on the moon. The third stage of the Saturn V that carried the Apollo missions 11, 13, 14, 15, 16 and 17 also crashed into the moon, and some of their positions are well known. Apollo 12's third stage was planned to go into a solar orbit, but due to venting of its fuel tanks, it didn't have enough propellant and ended up in a stable orbit between the Earth and the moon. Even though Apollo 13 never landed, its spent third stage was detected hitting the surface, and the impact crater has been captured by the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter camera some 135 kilometers away from the Apollo 12 site. Apollo 12 and all the following missions left behind the ALSEP, or Apollo Lunar Surface Experiments package. This included a range of experiments like the seismometer, which picked up the Apollo 13 third stage impact, as well as other devices for the analysis of micrometeorites, the moon's gravity, magnetic field, solar radiation, atmosphere, and internal structure. Apollo 11 left behind the Lunar Laser Ranging Experiment, which is the only lunar experiment still to be working today, and uses an Earth-based laser to measure the distance from the Earth to the Moon with an accuracy of about 3 centimeters. The Apollo missions landed with a complete lander, but they couldn't return in the same way. Only the ascent stage of the lander took off to return the crew, and they had very strict weight limits. Too much weight and they might not make it back to the command module. Literally, every kilogram made a difference. And that was the reason for leaving behind a seemingly random list of objects, as we will see later. Once the crews had transferred from the ascent module to the command module, the ascent modules were released to crash back onto the lunar surface, except two. Apollo 13, which was used as a lifeboat to get the crew back to Earth and it burned up in the Earth's atmosphere, and Apollo 10. Apollo 10 was a complete dress rehearsal for Apollo 11, except for the landing. Gene Cernan and Thomas Stafford took the lunar lander to within 15 kilometers of the surface before returning. In fact, the ascent stage was deliberately short-fueled to stop the crew from attempting a landing on the moon, because if they did, they wouldn't have enough fuel to make it back to the command module. The Apollo 10 descent stage was left in orbit, but fell back to the moon and its position is unknown. After the crew had transferred, the ascent stage, nicknamed Snoopy, fired its engine until it ran out of fuel. This sent it out into an orbit around the sun, and it's still there, somewhere, in an orbit slightly shorter than the Earth, the only manned spacecraft left in space without a crew. If you look at the inventory of items left behind for each mission, you'll see a lot of really rather mundane items. Things like filters, urine and defecation bags, food bags, chair armrests, towels, batteries, earplugs, brushes, boots, tongs, tools, scales. In fact, over 800 items. NASA has created a 22-page document listing everything on the moon which you can download and peruse for yourself. But there are also some things that you think they would like to bring back, like the Hasselblad cameras, which were used to take on average 1,500 photos each. But no, they left behind 12 of the 14 taken on the Apollo missions. The astronauts were instructed to bring back just the film canisters and leave the cameras to make room for rock samples. This allowed an extra 25 kilograms of rocks to be brought back over 6 missions in place of the cameras. Of course, some things were just far too big to bring back, like the 3 lunar rovers along with their TV cameras. They were left behind to film the ascent from the moon by remote control on Earth. There was also a gold-plated telescope, the only one to make observations from the surface of a celestial body other than the Earth. Other things left behind were symbolic in nature and were not always officially sanctioned. We all know the US flags, but Apollo 11 also left behind a gold olive branch as a representation of peace. An Apollo 1 patch to honour the crew of Grissom, White and Chaffee who died in a fire during testing, and medals given to the families of the deceased cosmonauts Gagarin and Komarov. There is also the Moon Memorial Disc, which contained goodwill statements by Presidents Eisenhower, Kennedy, Johnson and Nixon, and messages from the leaders of 73 countries from around the world. The disc was made using the same techniques as early integrated circuits and is the size of a US 50 cent coin with the writing visible using a microscope. On Apollo 15, a 9 centimeter statue called Fallen Astronaut, along with a plaque commemorating the 14 US and Soviet astronauts which died during training, was unofficially placed on the moon by David Scott. And on Apollo 16, Charlie Duke left a photo of himself, his wife and 2 children on the surface. On the back he wrote, "This is the family of astronaut Charlie Duke from planet Earth, who landed on the moon on April 20, 1972. During and after the Apollo missions, the Soviets continued with their remote-controlled Lunokhod rovers 1 and 2 in 1970 and 1973. Lunokhod 2 operated for 4 months, traveling 42 kilometers and sending back 86 panoramic images and 80,000 TV pictures. Since then, there have only been satellites from the US, Japan, India and China, most of which have ended up on the surface, until December 2013, when the Chinese became only the third country to soft land on the moon with the Chang'e 4 and the Yutu or Jade Rabbit rover. Although the rover succumbed to a mechanical abnormality, probably caused by the lunar dust after 2 months, the lander, which is powered by a radioisotope thermoelectric generator and solar cells, was still in contact with the ground control some 4.5 years after it landed, and in theory, its power supply could last for 30 years. So what will happen to the things left on the moon? Some say that with no erosion, no wind, rain or volcanic activity, they will be there long after the human race has come to an end, in millions or even billions of years into the future. But they are forgetting a few things. Firstly, the lunar dust. It covers the entire moon and was created and still is being created by meteor impact. Although there is no wind to move it around, it becomes electrostatically charged from the sun's ultraviolet and X-ray radiation. This causes it to levitate and create a very thin atmosphere of dust, constantly rising and falling around the terminator line as it sweeps across the surface from lunar day to lunar night. Recent observations and experiments show that the dust builds up at a rate of around about 1 millimeter per 1,000 years. Now that sounds like a tiny amount, but in 1 million years, all the items on the moon would be under 1 meter of dust. And that's assuming we didn't do anything to make it worse. If we start mining on the moon, then the amount of dust raised will be much, much more. And with only 1/6 gravity and no air resistance, it could also travel a very long way. Then there is the sun. With no protective atmosphere like the Earth, anything on the surface is exposed to the full force of the sun's ultraviolet, X-ray and ionizing charged particles. Just look at its effect here on Earth on paint pigments and photos that have been left out in the sun. That lack of atmosphere also means there is almost no temperature regulation. So in direct sunlight, the surface can reach 127 degrees Celsius, and at night it can drop to -173 Celsius. The thermal stress of that 300 degree temperature range would also take its toll on anything left there. The photo that Charlie Duke left 47 years ago is probably completely bleached by now, as are the US flags, and pigments and painted surfaces will have degraded, and there's also the sandblasting effect of micrometeorites hitting objects over directly or the nearby lunar dust, which is highly abrasive. So while they may well in some ways last a lot longer than they would do compared to being left outside on Earth, they will meet the same fate and eventually crumble to dust. One of the reasons for Apollo leaving so much stuff on the moon was the limited weight they could carry back in the ascent module. With every kilogram making a difference, they had to choose what to bring back and what to leave. These were just some of the myriad of problems that had to be solved, often with very short notice on the missions themselves, not only for Apollo, but for every lunar mission that's ever been attempted. If you'd like to challenge yourself, then our sponsor for this video, Brilliant.org, has something that will be right up your street. Brilliant's daily problems provide you with a challenge and then the context and framework you need to work them out, so that you learn the concepts by applying them. If you like the daily problem, then there are more like it, so you can explore the concept in greater detail and develop your framework. If you're confused and need more guidance, then join the community in discussing these problems. These thought-provoking challenges will lead you from curiosity to mastery one day at a time. So what are you waiting for? Go to brilliant.org/curiousdroid and finish your day a little smarter. And the first 200 of you to do so will also get 20% off of the annual subscription and be able to view all the problems in the archives.